Hi everyone, and welcome to our presentation on deep recurrent queue learning for partially observable MDPs. I'm Dolev, Orgad, and here with me is Noam Siegel. We are research students at Ben-Gurion University of the Negev in Israel. We hope you find this presentation interesting. In this presentation, we'll show you the main ideas and results presented in the paper Deep Recurrent Queue Learning for Partially Observable MDPs, and eventually we'll present the work that we've done regarding this paper. This is an interesting variation on the classic deep queue network. Let's dive in.
Machine learning is a powerful discipline in computer science in which a machine algorithm attempts to perform some task in an optimal manner. Like supervised and unsupervised learning, reinforcement learning refers to a subset of tasks and algorithms. In this case, an intelligent agent takes actions in order to maximize the cumulative reward. If you haven't studied this field, we highly recommend looking at the sources in the description. In this framework, we look at tasks involving an agent and its interaction with an environment. At each time step, T, the agent receives an observation, receives a scalar reward, and executes an action. In the next step, the environment receives the action, emits another observation, and emits another scalar reward. This continues for as long as necessary. The agent should act in such a way as to maximize the cumulative future reward.
A classic example of an agent-based task is achieving a high score on the Atari 2600 games. The video console, introduced in 1977, offers hundreds of games environments, each one different, interesting, and designed to be a challenge for human players. In 2013, Bellemer et al. Introduced the Arcade Learning Environment, an open source Atari testbed for evaluating your AI agents. It's available in Python via the GIM API. There are many cool algorithms to try out for training agents, from dynamic programming to gradient descent approaches. You have many options to choose from. Without getting too technical, the Q-learning algorithm is an attractive choice since no model of the environment is necessary and the agent learns an optimal policy while acting a different exploratory policy.
In 2013, scientists at DeepMind published the first article describing a deep learning-based model which successfully learns control policies directly from the pixels as input. The model was so successful that it was published 2 years later in the prestigious journal Nature. At the time, it was established that DQN outperforms the best available computing methods and even human experts on most of the games. So how does this deep Q learning thing work? If you haven't studied classic Q learning, you should stop this video now and learn about it, then come back. In many scenarios, the state space is way too large to store the Q value for every state and action pair. In deep Q learning, we use a deep neural network to approximate the Q value function. This neural network is called a deep Q network. In the paper, the authors pre-processed the video, resized it to 84 by 84 pixels, and stacked 4 frames on top of each other at every time step. This input was fed to 3 convolutional neural networks, then a fully connected hidden layer with 512 rectifier units. The last output layer is a fully connected linear layer with an output for each valid action. Finally, the values are updated just like in classical Q-learning using the Bellman equations. Up until now, we analyzed tasks modeled by Markov decision processes. This means that at every time step, the agent knows all the information about the new state. But in the real world, oftentimes our agent only observes parts of the world and other parts are left unknown or uncertain. This poses a challenge for Q-learning based algorithms, which assume full observability in order to converge. We will now see one way to deal with this. So we are done with the introduction. Let's talk about the amazing paper by Matthew Hausknecht and Peter Stone from the University of Texas at Austin.
Deep reinforcement learning has already yielded proficient controllers for complex tasks. However, these controllers have limited memory and rely on being able to perceive the complete game screen at each decision point. DQN is trained using an input consisting of the last n states the agent has encountered. Therefore, any game that requires a memory of more than n frames will appear non-Markovian because the future game states and rewards depend on more than just DQN's current input. Instead of a Markov decision process, the game becomes a partially observable Markov decision process. The author's approach was to modify just a small part of the DQN network so they can focus on the effect of the added recurrency. I will explain the modification in the next slide. In order to test the performance of the new DRQN, they also presented a method that converts MDPs to POMDPs, flickering games. They did that because they understood that given the last four frames, almost every Atari game is an MDP, because the location and the velocity of the game objects are easily detectable when given the previous frames. Using that method, at each timestamp, the screen is either fully revealed or fully obscured with some probability. Obscuring frames in this manner induces an incomplete view of the environment, causing the game to become a POMDP. LSTM, long short-term memory. The long-term dependency problem is a known problem of recurrent neural networks to remember information for long periods of time. LSTM cell solves this problem. The cell remembers values over arbitrary time intervals. Its three internal gates regulate the flow of information into and out of the cell.
In order to test the effects of recurrency, the authors minimally modify the architecture of DQN. The new network, DRQN, now takes a single game screen image instead of four stacked images. Like in the DQN, the images are convolved three times. The results are fed to an LSTM layer with 512 units. Finally, the last layer outputs 18 Q values that represent the 18 actions that can be taken in the Atari game. Here in the figure, you can see the changes from a DQN to a DRQN. The authors compared the DQN and the DRQN networks on different games. Here are the best and worst games for DRQN. As you can see, DRQN outperforms the DQN on the game of Frostbite. It's interesting to see how, after 12,000 episodes, DRQN discovers a policy that allows it to reliably advance past the first level of Frostbite. Also, note how the DRQN does significantly worse on the game of Beam Rider.
These nine Atari games were chosen as good candidates for recurrent learning in this paper. Given the last four frames, all these games are MDPs rather than POMDPs. Thus, there is no reason to expect DRQN to outperform DQN. And indeed, the results indicate that on average, DRQN does roughly as well as DQN, sometimes better and sometimes worse. In the second experiment, the authors trained the networks on normal games, which are MDPs, and then evaluated on flickering games, which are POMDPs. Each data point shows the average percentage of the original game score over all nine games in the table we showed before. It's really nice to see how DRQN's performance degrades more gracefully than DQN's.
Reinforcement learning is a subset of machine learning where agents aim to choose actions which give them the maximal rewards. Deep Q learning has been successful in training agents to play Atari games with human level control. Partially observable environments like flickering Atari games challenge the DQNs because of their limited memory. The deep recurrent Q learning network replaces the first fully connected layer with an LSTM layer. Even though it is given one frame per time step, it successfully integrates information through time. The DRQN can better adapt evaluation time if the quality of the observations change. This could be very useful in real-world scenarios where, for example, robots have partial observations or uncertainty about the state.
We will now discuss our attempt to reproduce the results of the paper. Our code is written in Python and uses the Keras API. We implemented both networks, DQN and DRQN. Initially, we tried to train the agents on the Frostbite game, but realized there is not enough time with the computer resources to finish training. We decided to try a different environment.
We found the Slime Valley Gym environment, which has the following properties. The input is an 84 by 84 pixels image, and the previous game screen frames are crucial to understand the state, for example, to calculate the velocity. We expected this game to converge faster because it has 6 controls instead of the 18 in Frostbite, and there are fewer objects to recognize in the green screen. We trained for 44 hours. The behavior policy during training was epsilon greedy, with epsilon annealed linearly from 1.0 to 0.1 over a pure parameter number of steps, and fixed at 0.1 thereafter. But guess what? This was still not simple enough. We ran the models in the university GPU cluster. It is a Linux machine with a Slurm workload manager configured to run on many different types of GPUs. We checked 2 hyperparameters, epsilon step and buffer length, which controls the length of the exploration period of the agent and the amount of previously encountered experience available to the agent. We trained for 44 hours and stopped due to time limits. We didn't achieve any convergence or significant progress with the agent's behavior. Unfortunately, we realized that we'll have to wait more time in order to see even the slightest advance. Thank you for watching this presentation. We hope you enjoyed it.